Well, once again, we had some technical difficulties. Jim was...
Are we broadcasting?
Yeah.
Okay,
Jim
good.
Was Jim was caught sipping on the wild turkey.
The computer was sipping on the wild turkey.
As I said before, if you didn't hear before we went on that venture of internet interference, as you can see, I am not Curtis. I'm in no form or fashion Curtis. Curtis is much bigger than me.
But both of you are the Son of God.
Listen to this. Oh my
yes.
God.
Yes. You can each call yourself the Son.
I am the Son of God in this form, and Curtis is the Son of God in the form that the Father's given him.
Yes.
Short.
David.
Okay. The compact son.
That's right.
I'm the stretched out son.
Tactical. He's tactical.
I know. Anyway, thank you for joining us this morning. A little late, but we thank the Father. Matter of fact, when everything was going haywire here, I had to remind my dear brother of his message last week about circumstances and situations. No big deal. No big deal. Some people get stressed out when stuff happens because everybody wants to be perfect. And unfortunately, perfect in the mind of a human is not the same as perfect in the mind of the Father. It's not. And we want to perfect the flesh. And he says, guys, you can't perfect it. I've taken him to the cross. And guess what? I've got something better. No. I've got something new for you. Mm-hmm. Not better, not mm-hmm. different. Not improved. There is no improved Curtis.
Nope.
There's only the new. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, another. Anyway, this morning we are going to take a look at, we're going to continue with Galatians 2:20. You've heard me say in the past, I really don't get into doing series. And it's amazing to me the Father has brought us to a time where we did four messages on desensitization and homosexuality. We did three messages on the tripartite man. It's kind of working that way, but I'll go with it. I'm not in worried about the box, because most of you live in the box. What do I mean by that? In the tripartite man, a rectangle or unbroken line represents what? The body, the flesh. Most of us live in the box, in the flesh, in the square, in the box. And so, the only way not to live in the box is see that you can look and live outside the box, live through the box. That's another message for another time. Anyway, would you like to pray for us, honey, so we can...
Sure. Commence. Gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you for bringing us all together. I thank you for the electronics and the ability to reach those that are not here. I pray for the message you have for us today. Pray for David to receive and for those of us listening to hear the words you have for us specifically as well. Thank you for being new and living out who you would have us to do, have us to be on a daily basis. And we thank you as your sons. Amen.
Amen. Turn your Bibles right quick to Galatians 2:20. We're just going to read this verse again. Well, never mind. Jim can bring it up on the notes, but turn to your Bible, Galatians 2:20. We're just going to look at it first before we, you want to read that, sweetie?
Oh, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me.
Good. So let's read that from the top.
In my last time of fellowship with you, we discussed that I had been reading from the new book by our brother, Dr. Warren Litzman, titled The Joy of Knowing Who I Am, The Fundamentals of the Christ Life. He was discussing Galatians 2:20. He provided an excellent explanation to Paul's words, I am crucified with Christ. And he went on to say how the Apostle Paul came to this powerful knowledge and understanding. This word came by the revelation of Christ. Paul came to know he died at the cross with Christ. As we said last fellowship, at the time Paul wrote and said, I am crucified with Christ, No one else knew or saw this mystery of the cross. But let's continue with this marvelous and powerful verse. Brother Litzman goes on to say, I am crucified with Christ. It was old Satan who said you could be a God of your own. You could be your own person. This is a lie. So the I am has got to be crucified. I am crucified and canceled out. The Greek for that says, I am canceled out with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Oh, that is a paradox. It almost looks contradictory. Nevertheless, I live. As Brother Warren said, the Apostle Paul's statement, nevertheless, I live, that is a paradox and looks contradictory. As we have discussed earlier, Paul's I am crucified with Christ is derived from a completely new knowledge and understanding concerning the cross of Christ. He said this revelation did not come from a man, which means his new knowledge was not learned academically, intellectually, philosophically, biblically, or scripturally. There was nothing written concerning him or anyone else personally dying on the cross with Christ.
Let's pause for a second with that before you go on. We need to emphasize that for just a minute. I don't see where that has that idea, that word that Katherine just read, grips us to the point where we actually see this little line that his new knowledge was not learned academically, intellectually, philosophically, biblically, or scripturally. I don't think that takes hold to the average person. I don't think that takes hold to the average believer. Because everything we do today is based on something we get from something outside of ourselves. We have to. That's what we rely on. We all walk and live in the box. It's in the box. The tripartite man, remember, is a rectangle, broken line. That's the body of the flesh. So we live in the box. Our identity has to do with the box. So therefore, everything we learn is either academically, intellectually, philosophically, biblically, or scripturally. Nothing was written at that time that gave anyone in that hour about dying with Christ. Not anything. So when Paul opened his mouth and said that from Revelation, nobody could comprehend that. And so I'm saying that to lay the foundation for where we're going with the whole verse, not just that one line, I am crucified with Christ. The whole verse was revolutionary. The whole verse was, you couldn't go to the great scholars of the day and say, do you know what happened when Christ died? Was that something? Did you actually see that, Charlie? Vivian? Oh, yes. I was just reading about that. I was looking at the old scrolls, and it said when this man, Jesus of Nazareth, died, everyone died with him. Didn't happen that way. Sadly, it doesn't happen that way today. Even though we have everything that people say, everything God is saying is already, his final revelation is here. Is it? Is it? Is his final revelation in this book? Is God not saying anything else? Well, I want to tell you, the answer to that is yes and no. Yes, he's given it to us in the book. Paul has given you what God gave him, but Paul did not understand what he meant by that. The only one that can give that to you is the Father himself, because it's his revelation that is being expressed. So if you read this book, the answer is not the book. The answer is in the Spirit from the Father who provided that knowledge to Paul. Not that Paul's knowledge is irrelevant, because God is speaking to every one of his sons today. Every son of God has access to the same Spirit that revealed that knowledge to Paul. He is, by that same Spirit, revealing it to his sons today, the ones that are hungry, the ones that are open to receive, the ones that want to know who they are. So there's things in this verse that we read academically that we still can't see. There's things that we read in this verse intellectually that still doesn't provide us to know that. I mean, how long has this been written? And people still don't know that they died with Christ. So that tells us just having it written down is not necessarily the final answer. Is that your final answer? God, is this your final answer? The answer to that question is no. Why? Paul, from the same revelation, goes on to say, which we'll get to here in a minute, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, neither has it entered the hearts of men the things which God has prepared for them that love him, because he has revealed these things unto us, Paul says, by his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. So if that's the case, if he is telling us it's spiritually revealed, then how do we think academics, intellectual, philosophically, biblically, or even scripturally is the answer to having us know what it means to be crucified with Christ, yet living? Nevertheless, I live. So we're going to approach this not from a macro. I had no intention of going this route. I was, after we received this word of I've crucified with Christ, I thought we were done. Because I had some things I wanted to go into. I want to get to Ephesians chapter 1. That's some things I was reading in Ephesians chapter 1 that just blows you away. Ephesians chapter 1 blows you away. So, but the Spirit said, I was sitting at the computer, and he said, now, I want you to do next time, nevertheless I live. Then after that, yet not I. Nobody does that. Yet not I. We say, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. We want to jump, right? That's not the way he gave it to Paul. Do you know after yet not I is a comma? What does the word comma, what does the comma do? It means what? Pause. Wait a minute. Don't run through this. So right now, we're looking at something that we have not received, you should not have received, academically, intellectually, philosophically, biblically, or scripturally, which removes the intent of the box and says clearly, you're not going to find it in the box, Curtis. This is something that the box can't produce. So it needs to be outside the box. But didn't Jesus, all things are created by him? Didn't he fulfill all things? Yes, he does. Created the box. But something happened to the box at the cross. Okay.
Shall I continue?
Yeah, please. That was just a commercial for where you're going.
From this new revelation, he continued to proclaim this new knowledge and understanding again and again. His revelation of Christ also confirmed to Paul he is the recipient of this action of the cross. And it is a simple statement of fact. He had come to see something unbelievable. He saw when Christ died, he died. The cross was then in the past, but the revelation of Christ made it now and personal. Paul was personally involved, included with Christ, in him on the cross. He now, as they say, had skin in the game. No one in Paul's day had grasped or had a clue they died at the cross. No one in his day saw the cross personally as their own death. They all saw the cross of Jesus as something that was done for them and not done to them. No one other than Paul comprehended that two races of people on earth died at the cross with Christ. And sadly, it is not much different in the religious and secular world views of today. So we will examine what the Father is saying through these next precious and powerful words in this verse. Following his first unbelievable words of, I am crucified with Christ, he then says, nevertheless, I live. That's our then and now paradox. As we go deeper into this verse, the Holy Spirit will draw our attention into something unique. When we read the verse, we see 44 words that make up the verse. What's unique is that 1/5 of those 44 words are personal pronouns, I, me, and my. The words Paul is using makes everything in the verse personal. It causes all of us to have skin in the game. This says the whole verse deals with union, oneness, and identity. I call this the IOU in Christ. Let's look at nevertheless. What does this mean? It means also, and, but, moreover, and now.
That's good. we gave a lot of the information we had from last time we fellowshipped on this, I am crucified with Christ. And the reason why I was led to put a lot of that in there was because I wanted us to keep in mind where Paul had taken us. He had taken us to a place to see we died. He had taken us to a place to see what happened at the cross. We died with Christ. Nobody understood that. But he's now saying something that even though I died, he said, nevertheless. Now, Catherine was reading the definition. I was looking at that in the Greek. The definition for nevertheless is a Greek word that means also, but. In other words, but I live, and I live, moreover I live. And he says, now I live. I kind of like the word now I live. I am crucified with Christ. Now I live. Now, we don't want to skip a stone through, you know how you throw a stone and go, and every place it looks cool, you know, it looks cool. You see that stone hit the water and it skips and boom, boom. And then we used to play a game, you guys might have done that. You throw a stone, see who can skip to get the most skips out of it. But when the stone is skipping, there's portions of water that's not being touched. We don't want to skim the stone of this verse. We don't want to skim from, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. We don't want to skim, because when we skim the stone intellectually, psychologically, physiologically, academically, we miss that portion of the water that needs to be touched. So we're going to jet ski through this. We're going to touch every aspect of the water. Now, Paul is saying here, I live. Now, our question would be, see, remember, this is a new understanding. This is a new idea. This is a God idea. Paul didn't come up with this. This is from the Father. This is a God idea, Sylvia. It's a God idea. So he not only had a God idea about I'm crucified with Christ, everyone died at the cross. He also said, but now I live. Now, if you rush past nevertheless I live, you're going to miss something unique and special in this verse. This verse contains 44 words in the whole verse. One-fifth, every 5.5 words, there's a personal pronoun. That should mean Curtis touched a little bit of this last week. There's personal pronouns. And every personal pronoun deals with something that affects you. It deals with identity. It deals with union. It deals with oneness. This verse is a key verse in union, oneness, and identity. Now, I used to say IOU was union, oneness, and intimacy, because union leads to oneness. Oneness leads to intimacy. You cannot get to intimacy without beginning at union. Mm-hmm. Union produces oneness. Oneness produces intimacy. But in this case, as I was writing this yesterday, I started like this past week, but when I was writing it, the Spirit said, identity. I had not thought of that before. I had not seen that before. Union produces oneness, and oneness produces identity. We become, they that are joined to the Lord are what? One what?
Spirit.
One Spirit. That's identity in the Spirit. That's identity out of your oneness and union. So I can go with that. I can go with that because he gave it to me. So I'm going to go with that based on that idea. Just like he gave me intimacy. Just like I know a man and a woman can't find intimacy until they first have union. Mm-hmm. That leads to oneness. That leads to intimacy of love. Now, identity doesn't lead to love. Intimacy does. But anyway, so we're going to take another look at this. Catherine will, if you will, continue to read. We're going to look at something. We're going to get to the crux of this, because everything in this verse deals with union, oneness, and identification, identity. Paul is giving us something from the Spirit, from the Father, from Christ, about something that no one at his day knew. They didn't know they died, but they knew they lived. For instance, remember this. Paul is looking back at the cross, correct?
Mm-hmm. It's in the past.
Am I boring you here?
No. These lights make me tired.
Is that what it is? You want me to? I can do a sub. I can get Curtis in here.
You want to?
I can bring Curtis. He won't do that.
He won't do that.
But anyway. As long as he doesn't get up here and tear his shirt up, I'll be fine. Don't you love? I love this. I'm not trying to. I'm not trying to. Here you go, brother. We're gonna run. Coach put in a new player. The coach just sent in a new player. I love it. Don't you just love live broadcast stuff? You never know what's gonna happen. You never know. With a box of chocolates, you didn't turn your mic on, did you? No, I didn't think you did, brother. Only at In Christ Ministries International do we have. You wouldn't see that at most Baptists. You wouldn't see that. They want things to go perfect. Well, I want to let you know. Turn it on, Jim. This is perfect. Oh my gosh. Wait, maybe not. This is perfect. straighten him up. Straighten it up. Okay. Let's continue. Not only did no one in Paul's day understood what happened at the cross when Christ died, no one understood. Remember, Paul was looking backwards. So he understood when he said, when the Spirit gave me, I'm crucified with Christ. But yet, think about this. When Christ died, was Paul living? Yes, he was alive. So when he says, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, there is a space between Calvary and everyone's life. Everyone was living when Jesus died, even though something God did, we'll get to that in a minute, something God did apart from them, they still live. There's a reason why Paul said, nevertheless I live. There's a reason why there's people who live today, even though they're living in the box, they're living. And there's a reason they're living. And we rush right by this. There's a union in here. There's a union at the cross, but nevertheless I live, there's a union and an identity that he is identifying with those words. So let's go. Let's read this.
Let's repeat these again.
Mm-hmm.
Also I live, and I live, but I live, moreover I live, and now I live. I am crucified with Christ, now I live. These words bring us into actual time. So Paul is saying, I was crucified and died with Christ, and even though that happened, I live. Who lives? Let's read the verse with the proper noun, David.
I prefer to use the proper noun, Curtis. But I didn't write that way, so you're going to...
This is in your name, you read this.
Okay. Okay. He's sitting here now, just pull in out of, off the bench, and he's coming in the game, giving instructions, taking over. That's why Jenny didn't want to sit here with you. I understand that now. So let's take a look at this. We're having too much fun, I think. But let's take a look at this. David is, or am, crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, David lives. Yet not David, but Christ liveth in David. And the life which David now lives in the flesh, David lives by the faith of the Son of God, who loved David and gave himself for David. All of those are not only personal pronouns, now they're proper nouns when you put your name there. I used to do this all the time years ago when I first got into the message. I used to have people read this verse and put their name in there to grasp an idea what Paul is saying in this verse. The thing I did not see, and it's okay. It's okay if we don't see these things. It's okay if we talk about the things we're seeing at the moment. There's nothing wrong with that. But you should always leave space for God to increase the revelation of the mystery to you. That's what my gospel is all about. It's an ongoing revelation of this person that not only lives in me, but that I have become because of Christ in me. Of the Son of God as me. So it's okay. I used to do that. I haven't done it in a while, but I used to do this. You put your name in there. I used to have people sit down at the same time, read this verse and plug their name in. And I heard a lot of people say, man, I never saw that before. I really, and that's what I saw. That's what the Spirit used at that moment. But now we're seeing something different. Let me read this for you.
Okay.
The first personal pronoun is in union with death. I am crucified with Christ. The first pronoun gives us union with death. This union identifies David as dead. Curtis. The identity of who David was at the time of the cross died. Which means David died at the cross even though he was not conceived, born, or even thought of in the minds of the box. Moreover, David can live after the cross. How? Why? Paul knew before the revelation that he still lived. In other words, Paul was in a day when Jesus of Nazareth had died on the cross. That was a physical occurrence. He knew that. So when he saw that he died with Christ, he also knew he lived. I mean, that he lived. Nevertheless, I live. I died, but nevertheless, or moreover, I was living. I still live. Why? Why was I still alive? I mean, that's a paradox. People do that today. Jenny does that. Rhonda does that sometimes. Everybody does that. We don't grasp that. We know we live, and it doesn't fit the way that who I am to myself, the I that I am to myself, live. And we struggle with that. People struggle with it. Even people who proclaim Christ lives in them still struggles with the idea I live. Why? Well, you can say, well, because they don't understand they died at the cross. No, that's not it. It's bigger than that. So if you just read on through this, you'll miss that. There's a reason when Jesus died, people still got up the next morning and lived. That night they went to bed. They took him off the cross, took him to the tomb, but all of Jerusalem who was involved in that whole idea went to bed that night and woke up the next morning. The day God put Christ in you, the day you were born again, you went to bed that night not knowing what that meant. Did you not? Yes, you did, and you did too. Everybody here shaking their head, but you did too. You went to bed not knowing what that meant. Other than, oh, Jesus saved me, died for my sin, and I received Jesus into my heart. Maybe that was the kind of idea you had. Depends on what church you're going to. You did not know what happened. You know that you live. You were in a body. You stayed at a certain house. You were in a family. You knew you lived. So that's what Paul is with this. That's necessary. Let's read on. He still walked, talked, and lived as the person he knew himself to be. He was... And he was, I'm talking about Paul, was an I, me, or my personally living day to day. You are still an I, me, or my. Right, Curtis? You got that? You never stop being an I, me, or my. Even with the cross, you never stop being an I, me, or my. That's important to understand. You know why? Because in the I, me, and my, that's a personal you that is accountable to God. There's a personal you that either will spend eternity with the Father or not. You will know you are not with him, or you will know you with him. The bottom line is the I, me, and my always is. The issue is the identity of I, me, my in its union. You follow? In your union, in your oneness, and in your identity. So let's go on. Let's read on. He could clearly see there was an I that died, and now there is an I that lives. Now, very few break that down like that. I am crucified, yet I live. Nevertheless, I live. Moreover, I live. So there's an I that died. Now there's an I that is and lives. And the I that lives in this particular portion, these three words, nevertheless I live, that was an I that was there before the cross, during the cross, and after the cross. Because there's someone that's speaking here. Okay, let's go on.
He could clearly see.
Yes, he could clearly see that I that died, and now there is an I that lives. A good place to start to see Paul's understanding of his personal pronouns is in Romans chapter 7. Paul uses 50 personal pronouns in just 25 verses. Now, I put, as you can see on the notes on the screen, Jim's got up there, 33, 12, and 5. 33 I's, this is the only chapter in the New Testament that has that many personal pronouns of I. I is 33, me is 12, and my is 5. In that verse, there's more personal pronouns than any other verse in the New Testament, chapter-wise. Because there's 1 Corinthians has a tremendous amount of personal pronouns, but the I, me, my personal pronouns is relevant and stands out in Romans chapter 7. So with that said, Curtis, yes. You want to do this or you want me to do it?
Romans 7, mm-hmm. verse 7, verses 9 through 10, and verses 14 through 25. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law. For I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. For I was alive without the law once. But when the commandment came, sin revived, and I died. For the commandment which was ordained to life, I found to be unto death. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For that which I do, I allow not. For that which I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I. If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Now, then it is no more. I do, brother, this verse is tough. Now, then it is no more
I
that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not. For the good that I do not. Brother, that's tough.
For the good that I would, I do not. But the evil that I would not, that I do. For I do that which I would not. It is no more I that doeth it, but sin that dwelleth in me. For I find a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my flesh. O wretched man that I am. I highlighted that just for a second. You don't have to change. You can leave it on the screen, Jim. I highlighted the word, O wretched man that I am. He is saying that the I am in this verse is alive. O wretched man that I am. So the I am in this verse is alive. And he's associating the I am with the body that he's living in. So that's him, his whole person. I, the old wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me, pronoun, from the body of this death? I thank God through Christ Jesus our Lord that with the mind I serve with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin.
Okay, what makes that so tough to read are all those pronouns.
Correct.
That is a difficult verse to read because the pronouns are just stuffed in there.
It is. And they identify, they provide what? Union, oneness, and identity. All of them provide union, oneness, and identity. We can't get away from that. So when we're reading Galatians 2:20, if you take nevertheless I live and just zip through that, you're missing something. There is an I that you are that does not go away. It can't go away. It will not go away. Not in the sense that we live. Nevertheless, I live. And I, like I said, back in verse 14, he said, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal. I am flesh. I am. So what happened with I am crucified with Christ? He's giving us something that you don't normally see. He's telling us in Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. The person that I am in this outer man died. The body I know myself as died. Right there on the cross with Jesus. Everything that makes me who I am in this body died. Nevertheless, there's an I that lives. Who is this? Why did I live? Let's go on. You got something?
You know, yeah. You have to really try hard to put all those eyes in there. He's making a point.
He is. Thank you. Yes. 50 times in 25 verses.
You have to try.
50 times in 25 verses. And Curtis is just is saying a mouthful here. You need to hear that. He's making a point. Let me take it a little farther. He's telling us something that he wants the readers to know. He's not just using I, me, and my 50 times in 25 verses just because he doesn't have anything else to say. He's speaking from a revelation that nobody in his day at that hour knew. 50 times. 33 I's, 12 me's, and 5 my's. No wonder it's a tongue twister.
It is.
And brother, when I used to read this verse before, I used to have the same issues, but now I don't have those issues anymore. Let's read. Nevertheless, I live. This chapter reveals the identity of the outer man and the inner man. Where your union is, your identity is revealed. Okay, you want to take it?
Philippians 1:22. But if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor. Yet what I shall choose, I what not.
Mm-hmm.
Paul now understood that when Christ died, he still lived after the cross. Yes, he now knew the cross of Christ was his cross. Nevertheless, he lived. Why? 2 Corinthians 5:15. And that which he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Romans 14:8-9. For whether we live unto the Lord, and whether we die unto the Lord.
Mm.
Whether we live therefore or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ both died and rose and revived, that he might be Lord both to the dead and the living.
Oh, whoa, look at that. That he might be the Lord of who? The dead and the living. Those who died and those who live apart from his life in them. Everyone is an I walking around. You either an I that is alive in Christ or you an I that is dead with Christ. You follow? Any questions on that? You guys got any questions? You can just email me that. Because we don't really see that. We run it all together to make a point. And Paul is giving us something we need to back away and look. Everyone that's not born again on the face of the planet is an I that lives. It's temporary. It goes from the time of birth to the time of death. But you're an I, and you're responsible for the I you are in this world. When that I comes to the place of seeing they need Christ, that I becomes a new person. It's a new I. But that's, we're going to get to that in a second. See? Okay. Go ahead, brother. Read that.
1 Corinthians 2:12. Now we have received, not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. And please remember how Paul can say these things. But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. For I neither received it of men, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ in Galatians 1:11-12. Paul tells us his statement is derived from a completely new knowledge and understanding concerning the cross of Christ. He said this revelation did not come from a man, which means his new knowledge was not learned academically, intellectually, philosophically, biblically, or scripturally. There was nothing written concerning him or anyone else personally dying on the cross with Christ. From this new revelation, he continued to proclaim this new knowledge and understanding again and again. Based on this new revelation of Christ, he would proclaim other unbelievable statements such as these. Ephesians 1:9, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself.
Now that little line means something completely different to me today than it did a week ago.
This is what you were going to teach on soon.
Mm-hmm. It means something different to me today. And what does that mean? It means that before I was born again, I lived. But the purpose of my living was not for me to live unto myself. I as a self unto self, or an I as a self unto I, but that I might live unto him who died and rose again. How can that be? The only reason I lived after the cross was so that I could understand there's a life to be lived. But I have to live to know I need to receive that life. Okay, go ahead, brother. Go ahead.
On this next line right here,
mm-hmm.
Isn't that reversed?
Let's read it and see.
The cross of Jesus is something that was done for them and not to them. No one other than Paul comprehended that two races of people on earth died at the cross with Christ. And sadly, it is not different in the religious and secular worldviews of today.
You left out the little line there on the bottom. Flip the page.
Might go straight to that, brother.
Really? It must have copied wrong then.
No. Go ahead. No, I'm sorry. I jumped the wrong pages.
Okay.
The cross. Let's go back to the scripture, to the writing. The cross is a God idea and a God action. This idea and action is apart from any human or angelic intervention. That simply means that we nor anyone else had a say in our death on the cross. Beloved, nothing survived the cross. Let me repeat that again. Beloved, nothing survived the cross. Your sin didn't survive. Your culture did not survive. Your ethnicity did not survive. Your race did not survive. Your sexual orientation didn't survive. Your gender didn't survive. Your religion did not survive. Your biological identity did not survive. I am crucified with Christ. In all-inclusive and conclusive to all humankind, every man, woman, and child born in the past, born in the present, and born in the future, they all were present and accounted for at the cross. Nevertheless, we live. 2 Corinthians 5:15, and that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again.
That's what we're talking about. The nevertheless I live is here. And that he died for all, that they which what? Live. Live right now. Live back then. That they should not live unto themselves, right?
Yes.
but they should not henceforth live unto themselves. They live, but right now they're living unto themselves. They're living in an eye that they know themselves to be in the flesh. They're living as a person that they were biologically born to be, even though that did not survive the cross. Listen, that is on God's part. That's what God did at Calvary. That has no meaning to the I that now live. It has no meaning. People are walking around the day not having a clue that they died at the cross. Yet, moreover, now, but they live. They live. They're living, and they're living for the sole purpose. Let's get to that. Let's read it.
2 Corinthians 2:14. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. For the things of the Spirit of God are foolishness.
Mm-hmm.
They cannot discern them.
Mm-hmm.
Neither can they know them.
That's correct.
Desensitization to the person of Christ sensitizes far too many to this body of flesh, the nevertheless I live mindset.
Oh, you get that, Jenny? Nevertheless I live is a mindset that means you live unto you. I'm a person unto me. I'm a person that was born in Texas. I was a person that was born in Ohio for you guys. I was a person that was born in a home with a mama and a mother and a father, or a father and a mother. I got a birth certificate that proves that. That's the nevertheless I live mindset. Keep going, brother.
This is not a bad place to be. It is a place where everyone really starts from. All of humankind begins here at nevertheless I live. So that God, the who wants and desires to birth us out of the I, we know ourselves to be in the flesh, to the new I we should become in Christ.
Did you follow that? So that God, who, that D probably shouldn't be there. So that God who wants and desires to birth us out of the nevertheless I, the I, live, we know ourselves to be in the box. Into the new I we should become in Christ. So the nevertheless I is important. Go ahead on, brother. You can read that.
Sadly, far too many read this verse with a thought in mind to reach a specific idea. And there's nothing wrong with that if that's where you are. But we should keep in mind that verse flows from the heart and the love of God to Paul. Every word written in it is beyond just specific words on a page. Paul would go on to say this in 1 Corinthians 2:9-12. But as it is written, eye hath not seen nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. You know, this brings back a verse that I shared last week,
mm-hmm,
about the deep things of God.
Mm-hmm.
The deep speaketh unto deep.
Mm-hmm.
The deep things of God speaks to the deepest parts of our being.
True.
Now, let's look at yet not I next time, because there is a comma after these words, yet not I. So let's see what the Spirit is saying concerning these three words.
Mm-hmm. Not only the three words, nevertheless I live, but yet not I. Now, most won't stop there. I've read this verse for years. I quoted this verse, and most of you can quote this verse. But I've never allowed the Spirit to take the time to teach me, nevertheless I live. Because, you know, before I received Christ, before the revelation of the mystery, before I knew I was the Son of God, there was a nevertheless I live. Technically, there was nevertheless I live even before I am crucified with Christ in my thinking, in your thinking. Those who are not saved, even some of those who are born again, still don't know I am crucified with Christ. What that means beside the words on the page. There's preachers preaching today all over this country, all over the state of Texas, who don't have a clue. It's something they read and they zip on through that. Even nevertheless I live. Even yet not I. But we'll look at yet not I next week. So you got anything you want to comment on this as we close here, brother?
No, just once again, I'm impressed with the fact that the focus is not only on I, but on live. When we came to Christ, we came because there was life. Mm-hmm. And death is a means to that life.
True.
And that life is Christ.
Correct. But in this case, nevertheless I live, it is not.
No.
It is not Christ. Paul is saying,
that's right.
You got it's hard to I'm gonna use a genieism. It's hard to wrap your mind around this. Mm-hmm. Because we've been programmed for so long thinking a certain way, even if it's from God, even if it's from the Father, even if it's his revelation to us, we can get locked in that one box and make that the whole. It is not the whole. It is not the W-H-O-L-E, although it can be H-O-L-E. You can fall in that H-O-L-E and never see the W-H-O-L-E. I live. Before I had Christ in me, I live. You say, well, brother, you were dead spiritually. We don't know that. We have no clue about that. So why do we think we can pick this up and just zip through it and get it all and say, oh, well, Paul said this, this, this. He did. But you need to have the understanding of the Father that gave it to him, that he expressed. I mean, I can tell you, he knew a lot more than he said, because the 2 Corinthians chapter 12 tells us he understood a lot more than he said, because he couldn't say certain things. For he said, I've seen these things, for it is unlawful for a man to speak. So the Father reserved the right to teach us what we are learning today. But we act like, well, I can read. I've got revelation. God showed me. That's good, brother or sister. You walk in that, live in that. But I can tell you, there's more of him than it is than we able to understand with just our boxes. Nevertheless, I live. Paul is saying, I live after the cross. He didn't get that right away. He didn't get that from the Damascus Road. When he was in Damascus, he proclaimed Jesus as the Son of God. He didn't know he had even died at the cross. But I tell you what, he knew he was living at that time. He knew it, he understood he was proclaiming Jesus as the Son of God, as the Messiah to those Jews that was listening to him, so much so they tried to kill him. He didn't have 1 ounce of revelation in the sense that he saw he died at the cross. He knew he lived and he was there to proclaim Jesus as the Messiah to Israel. Millions of people walk around today, nevertheless the cross happened, they live, but they don't have Christ in them. They live. People who today who don't know Christ lives in them, born again, nevertheless they live. So there's more here than meets the eye. And all I'm saying is, if you're inside your box of speeding through this verse, there's some union, some oneness, and some identity that we don't come to because we're trying to make a point here. And if that's where you are, fine. I did the same thing. For years, Sylvia's probably been with us here the longest. I did that. I preached and taught this. Not that it's wrong. It's just that the Father says, hey, there's a little bit more here I want you to see. 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, I couldn't have said this. I didn't see this. Just 3 weeks ago, Jenny, just 3 weeks ago, I couldn't say any of this. I quoted, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. That was what I knew. Was it life? Yes. Just 3 weeks ago. But I never saw the content of what we are saying about Paul in I am crucified with Christ. I never saw that before. I could quote that. I could tell you we died with Christ at the cross. I knew that. But I didn't see it from what the Father gave his son in Paul. I didn't see it from that. I didn't see it as something that was behind him. I didn't see that. So all I'm saying here, there's more here than us just taking Galatians 2:20 and make it a memory verse. To make it that we understand that we got it all because we've been proclaiming. I've been proclaiming this verse for 35 years. There's people who've been claiming it for a lot longer than that.
You know, truth is like it's three-dimensional and multifaceted. And just when you think you understand it, God takes you around to another side of it and says, now what do you think of that view?
Now, that's true. God takes you around it. That's true. The only caveat in that you're missing is most of us don't want to go anywhere with it.
we live in two dimensions, yeah, but truth is three-dimensional.
I won't go. No, don't show me that. I got what you got right here. I ain't going nowhere. You gave me revelation, and I'm good. I don't want to know anymore because that means people are going to go. No. So, yes, he does. He wants to show us more of himself. The purpose which he purposed where? In himself. And I want to know more of himself. If it means that I've had revelation and I've walked in that for 30 years or 35 years and the Father says something else, I'm going. I'm not afraid to go with it. Someone said to me once, she said, are you, they said, you think that you're right. You always think you're right. I've heard that more than once. My answer to that is, that's not how I think. That's what you think. Simple. That's what you think. If you want to know, you can ask me and I'll tell you what I think. I don't have a problem. They used to say, if you want to know, don't ask David, because he will tell you. But that's not what I'm thinking. Because you see, to be right, you have to be concerned about being wrong. Everything I'm giving you here, I'm not concerned about being wrong. Because I'm not concerned about being right. As I receive, I give. If there's correction need to be made, my Father will correct it. I'm not concerned about being right or wrong. Jenny, I'm not concerned. That's not my concern. My concern is that I'm not going to be obedient to what the Father is because of these other things that people are going to think or say. You never stop growing. You never stop growing if you're open to receive something other than what you already have. I'm not trying to say this like Paul. I'm not trying to say this like Curtis. I trust Curtis try not to say it like me. I told him that we had lunch the other day. I said, brother, you used my name far too many times in your message last week.
5 times.
Yeah, that's way too many times. To me. But if that's what he wants to say, that's fine. Because you don't have to say it like everybody says it. People try. Now, Curtis, when you're up there teaching, brother, you need to understand where we are in this. You know, you got to. You need to you let everybody know you agree with me. So you need to say it like I say it. Lest we can't let you speak.
Oh, well, just for the audience, you have never told me that. You have always said, say it the way that the Lord, the way that Christ is in you. Say it the way that the Father has said it to you.
That's
David
it.
Has never, ever told me or put boundaries on anything. And I just want the audience to know that. And when he says that, to make a point. But he has never done that.
No.
Never.
Not with cursing anybody else. You don't say it like I said. You're going to say it the way you see it comes out of you. Now, the fear is if you say it that way, is he going to come back and correct that? Is he going to come back and correct that? Is he going to make a correction? Sometimes if the Spirit leads, I will. But it'll be from the understanding of the mystery in me. So I'm not going to say it like Curtis. I'm not going to say it like Jeannie or Rhonda or Sylvia or Jim with a wild turkey. I'm not going to say it that way. Anyway, that's enough. We thank you for joining us this week in Sunday Fellowship. We trust the Father will continue to bring I'm trusting him to reveal what he'd have us to say next week with yet not I. That's just three words. But I'm quite sure there's more in that than just three words, yet not I. Now, technically, most would say, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. You can say it that way, but there's a comma there. There's a pause. There's a pause. Before, but Christ liveth in me. There's a yet not I. So I'm trust the Father. Maybe we'll recruit Curtis back next week or get Rhonda or Sylvia or somebody. Jenny, we get Jenny up here because Catherine's abandoned ship on me. He's abandoned ship on me.
Catherine,
anyway.
Yeah. Huh? Catherine looks under the weather today.
Anyway, thank you guys for joining us this week in Sunday Fellowship. We trust that you walk in the victory of being who you are as a son of God, living in the box that's been given you, but living outside the box that hinders you from being who you are with that box you got on. Amen?
That was a good message, brother. Thank you very much.
Amen. All right. See you next week. Thank you, guys.